topic is measurement qualities for the next data. And this is an important issue because the benefits which polarimetry offers actually tremendous, provided the quality of polarimetric data is appropriate. And that basically what prevents sometimes the utilization to the full extent the advantages of this polarimetric measurements. It was the case very often in the past where people bought these dual pole radars and simply didn't know how to utilize that, and then one of the reasons was that the quality was not as good and people didn't know how to deal with these quality issues. So the performance of polarimetric methods may not meet expectation if the quality issues are not properly addressed. And that's a very important message. There are several adverse factors that can negatively affect the quality of polarimetric data. Some of them are system related, which is poor design of the radar rather processor, poor antenna, for example, bad antenna. Very often people simply, a few years ago, didn't take care much about the antenna design, and simply used old antenna and dual polarimetric upgraded old antenna, which was not meeting the requirements for the polarimetric measurements. Poor calibration. CCDR and system differential phase, the impact of radome, the construction of radome, and also the wet radome when some accumulation of precipitation occurs, the appropriate connection correction for noise, because many polarimetric variables are affected by noise at much higher signal rate, signal ratio than radioactivity. There are some terrain related, and a partial beam blockage, ground clutter, contamination, atmosphere related, atmospheric attenuation, differential attenuation, we were talking about. The non-uniform beam feeling, we'll talk about at the end of this lecture. The polarization, cross-coupling. These 8 and 9 can produce very visible artifacts in a polarimetric rapid data, and people have to have some idea about the origin of these artifacts. There is a table that showing how different variables are affected by different adverse phenomena. Okay. It turns out that, for example, radar reflectivity is adversely, maybe adversely affected. Radar miscalibration, but wet radome attenuation, beam blockage, loss in calibration, non-uniform beam feeding. Differential reflectivity affected by even larger number of factors. However, there are certain factors, most of them phase-related factors, like Doppler velocity or differential phase, which are affected by much number smaller factors. Doppler velocity is a wonderful variable that is not affected by any of those. And that's why Doppler velocity measurements are so robust and so reliable, and people are so much relying on those. Okay, but again, with Z and ZDR are probably suffering from the largest number of these factors, and we have to cope with this somehow. What are indicators of radar quality, data quality? The radar sensitivity, the radar should be sensitive enough. Okay. Noisiness of the radar data, because if the radar data look very noisy, you know, that also raises concern about the quality of radar design and the processing, etc., etc. Maximal rho HV is something that actually emerges as probably the number one quality parameter for polarimetric radar. In other words, I mean, the signals at horizontal and vertical polarization should be correlated as much as possible, okay? And the correlation should be very close to one in rain, at least. Calibration of ZDR, quality of noise correction, quality of beam blockage correction, quality of ground clutter suppression, quality of attenuation correction, everything should be addressed. And I'll try to go through all this a little bit. First of all, radar sensitivity, I'm just in a design that is being selected for modern polarimetric radar used for operational applications, there's a division of the power between H and V channel, and because of this division, we experience this thing, we loss in the power. Okay, it's not very, very visible, but if you compare this one and this one, this is after 3 dB loss, you see a little bit less echo. And that was that meteorologists, at least in the United States, was very difficult to sell this idea of polarimetric radar, which is compromised by this 3 dB loss. There are ways to recuperate this loss. For example, first of all, increase the sensitivity using probably better receiver, increase transmitted power, but probably that's not that's probably most straightforward and brute way. But increasing improvement sensitivity of receiver, increase pulse length, increase dwell time. You cannot afford a lot of things like dwell time. For example, you need to have a good update time. There are some ideas about coherent summation of signal H and V channels. In other words, you can somehow recuperate this, at least partially, this 3 dB loss. Or simple dispatching the radar image. And I will show just a few examples of that. Just maybe one of that. But coherent summation of the power, if you do it, I mean, if you not simply sum up an average, say, signal and vertical and horizontal polarization, but do it in a more sophisticated way, taking into account the phases of the signal, then you can increase this sensitivity. However, you're not able to probably restore full 3 dB loss. Another thing is just dispatching. For example, if you have this standard dispatching techniques that were not widely used actually very often, especially in the United States, and where then people were mostly interested in monitoring severe storm development, so enough synchronous power there. So, dispatching, if you see some sort of at the edge of the echo, I mean sporadic appearance in the echo or noise or whatever, so you can, using some sort of dispatching techniques, you can definitely improve decision making on if you are identify signal as a meteorological signal or as a noise. Long dwell time, slower scanning, long pulse. And if you combine those all together, you can even do much better than before you lose this 3 dB. But that requires a little bit more intelligence, okay, signal processing power, and mostly more sophisticated algorithms. So, and we believe that the opportunities to do that are not exhausted. So it's a lot of opportunities ahead of us. Okay, now with all this advancement signal processing, we have clear path how to do that. And in a research domain, for example, we can measure, we can do quantitative measurements at signal ratio as low as minus 10, minus 15 dB. Whereas for most operational utilization, people simply sensor out signal less than, for signal ratio less than 3 dB, for example. And it's, we have a lot of, still a lot of room to progress. This is what showed the result of dispatching, again the same images, and with dispatching you don't see much difference between these two. Basically you almost recoup most of that lost signal. Noisiness of the radar measurements. By definition, the received signal is some sort of a stochastic process. Okay, so because it's basically the sum of the signal is formed as a sum of the many signal contribution from different particles that move with different velocities. So and it is basically a semi random conglomeration of different contribution from different particles. So by definition, there is a noisiness, there's an inherent noisiness that you cannot avoid in a signal from distributed scatterers and moving distributed scatterers. Okay, and this is a list of formulas that quantify the expected noise, which is totally normal. Totally normal, you cannot do better than with this noise. Here we assume that signal noise ratio is quite high enough, say more than 10, 20 dB. Okay, so sigma z, what is standard deviation of the z estimate obtained if we sum up m pulses, okay, of signal? Okay, and it depends on the so-called normalized spectral width, and which is this ratio. It's 4 actual spectral width by pulse repetition period divided by lambda. Okay, and so this error in radar reflectivity depends on these two factors. It depends on at least several physical factors like W, P, lambda, and M, basically. And you have to expect different values for different combinations of these variables. For sigma V, we have another formula. Okay, that's again includes the same thing, spectral width, pulse repetition period, number of pulses. Okay, and for the same thing for spectrum width itself, for differential reflectivity, for three polarimetric variables, there is another important factor that's come into this formula. It's namely cross-correlation coefficient, which is not here. So if you look at all these three formulas, you figure out, so they close the cross-correlation coefficient to 1 in this formula, in this formula, in this formula. The smaller sigma of ZDR, sigma VDB, sigma ratio. That's why it's so important to design the radar, polarimetric radar, really well. So the design antenna that doesn't artificially decrease this correlation. So cross-correlation coefficient should be more than 0.99, at least should be measurable. Such high cross-correlation coefficient should be measurable in the system. Otherwise, you know, your noisiness of the most variables will start increasing beyond the limit. Okay, that's why it's very important message actually shown here. Standard errors are very sensitive to the magnitude of cross-correlation coefficient. And that's one of the old slides when we had one of the radars which is poorly designed radar. You see if it's Z, Ryzhkov units function of Z, it never has, I mean, more than 0.97 or whatever. Or some sort of lemon radar that basically was not utilized for much of research actually. So, but if you took a look at this ATD radar for the one that is being utilized in the United States and S-band, you see here almost one. There's plenty of reliably measured cross-correlation coefficients. But some sort of decrease in radar reflectivity is expected, okay, for natural reasons, because the cross-correlation coefficient depends not only on the system parameters, but only on the signal, on the properties, microphysical properties of precipitation itself. Same thing, say, for CMAP, for example. So you have plenty of measurements very close to one. So again, there is a sort of requirement that maximum Ryzhkov range will exceed 0.995 for signal modulation more than 20-25 dB. So it is one of the most important requirements that should be met. How can we figure out if our data are normally noisy? In other words, noisy but in a normal way, so that our noise doesn't exceed whatever is expected for the given parameters, for the given dwell time, for the given spectral width, for the given cross-correlation coefficient. So what we are doing, we simply, let's take radial radio dependence of just raw differential reflectivity. That's how it looks like. You see, the requirement for measuring the differential reflectivity is 0.1, 0.2 dB. The natural variability is much, much, much more. Okay. That means that we need to do something. Is it normal or not normal? So the question. Because we need probably to do some sort of spatial averaging, averaging along the range, etc., etc. Okay, how to estimate the depth of these fluctuations? So what we do simply some sort of the averaging, running average with a long window, okay, and then subtract that is thick curve from the original data, and come up with this sort of a stationary random process, whatever, and estimate the standard error of these fluctuations. And that basically standard deviation of differential reflectivity. So the 0.3, 0.5, sometimes much, much more than that. If it's normal or not, then we have to compare with the formulas in the previous graph, the previous slide. Okay, if we well exceed this, well exceed those expectation, this one, so then something wrong with the system. If not, okay, that's, we are fine. All right, and this is an example of the texture of differential reflectivity and the differential phase, for example, in the case of polarimetric, for the bottom of the radar, for the case of polarimetric next radar. It's radar reflectivity cross correlation coefficient. And that's what we getting for typical next rad. ZDR, you see it's maybe in here, look in rain, it's maybe 0.2, 0.3 dB. That's a standard deviation, statistical error. Differential phase, say between 1 to maybe 2, maybe. However, there are areas where they're higher. That depends on spectral width. And depending on sigmoid ratio. The sigmoid ratio definitely goes up. Then, this is what we have for the University of Bonn. And let's say, if you compare this and this, the University of Bonn, very nice quality of the data here, 0.1, 0.15 in terms of ZDR's texture. And VDP, again, we are reading 1 dB, which is 1 degree, which is considered very good. So, compared to that one, what is the difference? There are two differences here. Why is this looks worse than the one in Bonn? The two reasons. First of all, dwell time is very different. For in United States radars, the number of pulses is about maybe 12 only. For you, Minister Bong, we have, I believe, 48, 64 or something like that. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, 48, sorry. So we have all these dependence m to the square root of m. Okay. And this, only this difference, four times difference, make two times smaller standard error. Okay. Another thing is that if you look at this, if you look more carefully into that formulas, original formulas, okay, you find out that sigma vn over here and sigma vn, so that's lambda actually in a numerator here. So that means that all these standard errors are proportional to lambda, square root of lambda. So the smaller lambda, the less noisy the variables. And we had some discussion with Julian in the break. And I told him that probably it's one of the advantages of using shorter wavelength radar. We can make have cleaner fields of radar variables for the same sort of dwell time. Okay. These are the CBAT, DWD basically. DWD, because I'm from in Bavaria. All right, it's radar fields, radar reflectivity, differential reflectivity. The differential phase cross-correlation coefficient. And this is texture. Again, the texture, we are in this bluish for ZDR and VDP. ROHV texture, again, we are measuring very high ROHV, which is very nice. We're getting to almost 0.995, a little more. So look here, there is one thing which is bothersome over there. You see this? This is indiscriminate ground clutter cancel. When we cancel ground clutter in a very indiscriminate way, so then we are really in trouble here. So that's where the texture parameters increase dramatically. Right, and we have to do it in a more intelligent way. Hopefully, they did not come. We didn't do that. This way. All right, then calibration of Z polarimetric. Self-consistency in rain, that what is our major hope, because in the absence of polarization diversity, okay, there's very little we can do to calibrate for absolute calibration rather effectively. However, with the invent of a polarimetric radar, we have another two parameters that do not depend on absolute calibration, which is differential phase, a specific differential phase, and differential reflectivity, which is a relative parameter. So that means that it is known that in rain, there is these parameters are very well interconnected. They are not totally independent. Okay, that means that if we measure KDP and ZDR, we somehow can estimate radar reflectivity compared to what actually radars observed with this KDP and ZDR. Okay, so we can invert the formula doing this way, and we can integrate over the some domain or along the range, along the ray, as says here. Okay, and we can compare these two big integrals, either or aerial integral or integral over the range, over the radial. Okay, and if Z here is biased, so we'll see that these integrals are not equal. So they have to be equal if the radar reflectivity is not biased. So the measure of this inequality is the bias, which can be estimated with an accuracy of 1 to 1.5 dB, which is not bad given the fact that even for the next rep, after the polarimetric update, you didn't do actually anything to capitalize on these capabilities. We still have 3-4 dB absolute biases, absolute errors in the reflectivity, unfortunately. Okay, so these are plots showing that basically how we can self-consistency in more quantitative terms at S band, C band, and X band. So in other words, here this KDP divided by Z, which is not the ratio, doesn't depend on consideration. And this ratio, how it depends on differential reflectivity. So how everything works, for example, we measure differential reflectivity equal to 2 dB. Okay, read what should be KDP divided by Z for that differential reflectivity, and check if it's really this number. If it's not, then your travel Z should be changed. The Z has some sort of bias miscalibration. Okay, the same thing for C band, S band, C band. Okay, those curves, although they are quite, scattered, of course there should be a lot of scattering. Okay, like that. And this basically, those curves were plotted based on analysis of about 50,000 of drop size distributions. Okay, that means that it's really tough dependencies. Okay, it's not all over the place. So this, with quite good accuracy, we can figure out what should be this ratio for the given differential reflectivity. And since KDP is not affected by the miscalibration, then any deviation from that is just due to miscalibration of radar reflectivity. you have to be careful for different radar, different radar wavelengths and C-band and X-band, especially because there is a inconsistency also curve depending on the temperature, C-band and S-band and X-band. For example, blue dots is for 0 degree temperature, and this red dots at X-band for 30 degree temperature. So there is some sort of uncertainty here that should be taken into account. However, say for typical Bonn weather, we are somewhere 15 degrees without much extreme, so zero, 30 degrees. I don't believe it. You ever have this 30 degrees, not air, but temperature of radiance of 30 degrees. So probably less than that. So shouldn't worry too much about that. Unless you are, you know, people in tropical countries, in tropical regions should be concerned. Okay, calibration and differential reflectivity. It's a big headache, and a big actual pain in the neck for all these operational services that are acquiring these polarimetric radars. There are different ways to address the issue of calibration and differential reflectivity. So there's a built-in automatic calibration procedure that uses some generated measurements. Using vertical sounding for NEXAR, for example, because of mechanical constraints, can simply look at it. And so this is prohibited for the NEXAR. Okay, another things which we I personally advocate all the time is checking differential of using the data themselves to and some types of hydrometers that can serve as a natural calibrators for differential reflectivity. For example, we know that in dry aggregated snow, it should be 0.1, 0.3 dB. And if it is different, that means that the whole difference is attributed to this miscalibration. Or in light rain as well. Okay. However, we need to take into account that ZDR especially affected by differential deviation, but we do this based on the data. And this is prominent impact at shorter wavelengths, C and X band. This is to show how the bias of differential reflectivity may affect the accuracy of rainfall measurements, for example. There are a couple of formulas that are being used for next round, the combination of Z and ZDR to compute rain rates. And depending on the bias of differential reflectivity, we may have, depending on which formula we are using, we may have quite substantial bias in actually in rain rates. For example, positive bias leads to underestimation of rain, if it's say 0.6, can be up to 40%, 80%, or 20%, depending on which formula is being used for rainfall estimation. So, we also, what we advocate is to probably using measurements of differential reflectivity in light rain to figure out if differential reflectivity is miscalibrated or not. And again, this is built on our experience in Oklahoma from many different types of events. We collected this drometer data, then compute Z and ZDR, and then plot each against other. Okay, what we figure out, okay, for say tropical system, because particles are smaller, usually raindrops are smaller than continental system. For the given radar reflectivity, we have a much smaller differential reflectivity, than for example in convective rain. But nevertheless, all these curves more or less converge when we are getting to the smaller numbers of radar reflectivities. So here's 25, so we don't get to 20. But in this curve, for example, we are showing these average dependencies from experimental data from Oklahoma, more continental rain to Florida, less continental, more tropical, and 100% tropical in Taiwan, for example. There is a big difference because of the in CZR curve. because of the different drop size distribution, different types of rain. However, when we get into the 20 degrees or whatever, those are converged. So that means that we have to, what we are doing, what we are recommending to do is some sort of data-based automatic software calibration of differential objectivity. In other words, we have a table for S-band, C-band, and X-band, okay, showing what kind of differential objectivity should be expected on very grand average. All right, for 20 degrees, 22, 24, 26, 28, 30 degrees. Okay. And then if the measured values are different from those, then we make a decision on how we have, how ZDR should be changed to compensate this bias. And that's something that is very easy to implement in software, and that's what we usually recommend to do. And this is a big example of how this technique works. For example, in the case, this is delta ZDR for three different rain events in Oklahoma. Okay, this is different scan, times and different scans. So what we do is we figure out, I mean, using that method which I illustrated in the previous slide. So we're simply following this differential reflectivity, median differential reflectivity for about 20 dBc or whatever. And it's relatively stable if you take enough data with another resolution volume. However, when they have a wet radome, and a wet radome, and it's raining over the radar itself, the wet radome produces something like about 0.4 error differential reflectivity. It's not related to the radar system, it simply produces by these rivulets of rain over the wet radar. And again, it acts as some sort of polarimetric grid. Basically, H polarization is totally transparent to that. But E polarization is reflected from this rivulets. So that's why we have positive. In other words, the signal at vertical polarization is more attenuating the reflected back than the signal that horizontal polarization. Okay, so another case, again, we are talking here, there are some changes, definitely, for one, we cannot make this sort of calibration assessment based on one scan, but whenever we do it, I mean, so for 30 scans maybe, so that will be, we are getting to some sort of a value which is a more or less reliable estimate of this ZDR bias. In that case, in this case, okay. So we do believe that with this sort of calibration, we are capable to estimate the actual bias of differential productivity with error plus minus about 0.2 dB, for example, which is enough for any quantitative measurements. Another thing is monitoring the system differential phase because why we need to do that, this is especially important for X-band. I will show you later that will be attenuation correction. The attenuation correction is being done using some formulas like that at VDP, total VDP. So the same thing as differential reflectivity. These formulas will be shown in the next slides. So that means that if VDP is basically is a difference between VDP systems, which is okay. This VDP system is not well monitored, and we are through this formula we are getting problems with the estimations of reflectivity, differential reflectivity. Okay, and I don't know. It's a relatively minor issue that can be relatively easily addressed. Again, looking at the first gates of the VDP along the radial, and using those for measuring the system differential phase. The processing of differential phase can be quite tricky and still, I mean, reliable procedure for estimating of especially the slow of differential phase radial dependence. Okay, still not, you don't have a really reliable procedure, but just like to show you that we, first of all, we measured it, any phase can be measured only with 360 degrees. Okay, minus pi to pi, 0 to 2 pi, okay. And if its actual phase is more than that, it can be much more than that. All right, so we have the so-called, I mean, this aliasing or folding or whatever, and we need to do something about that. And also the system differential phase, and again, my topic here, because we prefer it starts somewhere close over here, just close to, say, minus 150 degrees if you measure from minus 180 to 180 degrees. So if it starts like that, like in this case of Seemann radar in Valparaiso, then you have two of incident of this unfolding. So if you start from the correct starting position, we have only one of that. Okay. So, but anyway, so we need to control that and keep it close to, say, minus 150 degrees, not to minus 180, because then there will be a lot of crossing of the this phase boundary, which cause another problems. Then eventually we are coming up with this sort of a nice and monotonic curve, okay, from which we can find out the slope of each curve and find out what is the specific differential phase gating with the good accuracy. But again, the bottom line that a lot of processing and tricky processing may be required for differential phase and estimation KDP. The impact of radome. I already mentioned that the illustration that those rivulets can produce differential attenuation bias, with the sort of differential attenuation bias. And again, that at CNX band, this impact of radome can be really significant. And the worst case scenario is accumulated wet snow on the radome surface, not even rain. Wet snow. Wet snow, especially when it starts melting a little bit. Okay. Because the radome usually warmer than the surrounding air. And this is a very interesting example from the C-band radar in Toronto in Canada. Alright, this is differential reflectivity measured by the radar as a function of time. And you see that in a matter of half an hour, this area in this azimuthal sector north of the radar, so the area of very high differential reflectivity up to 2 dB actually disappears, and that is because it was precipitating, it was snowing over the radar, and the wind blew from that direction, from north direction. So the snow was accumulated only on one side of the radar. Okay. But, you know, once we see these sort of things, and we see that the radar, which is very difficult to control this sort of situation, when the radar can produce the bias of differential reflectivity, which is a strong function of azimuth, and the bias can be as large as 2 dB. So, what are you talking about when you would like to claim the accuracy of differential reflectivity measurements to 0.1, 0.2 dB? So we definitely need to identify those situations and either not to even bother to do any quantitative measurements over there or try to recognize it at least. That was that's what may happen. And again, this wet radar impact can be measurable even at S-band. There's some examples of the NEXRAD, recent NEXRAD. I don't even see it, but you know, probably not. It's supposed to be green here, this area. little bit different shape. It was raining on one of the ATD graders. Okay, and differential frequency bias was about 0.2 dB. Then rain stopped. Okay, and the bias normalized, gets to zero. All right, and there was an episode of two heavy rain, and another reflectivity actually of another side shows when we have rain, it's raining 30 dB, and then we have this terrain 25-30 dB again. And that increases differential reflectivity. Okay, what we measure not in the radar, but in a whole radar scan, basically. So you can see how the whole field of differential reflectivity sort of increases or decreases because of that. So, and again, this is an example at C-band, which was shown in one of the previous slides. So we can, at C-band is 0.4 dB, it can be 4.4 dB easier. At X-band can be even more. So, question?
Yeah, just a quick question. This differential must be due to runoff from the radome, right? Because the drops are not round on the thing, but the runoff is it. Yeah.
Yeah. They try to do all these things. They try to wax radome, they try to clean radome, just because these defects can be enhanced, can be aggravated, especially if the radome is dirty or whatever. Yeah. So, but you know, you can only improve this only to a certain point. Anyway, you have to deal with this. And the best way to deal with it is using this the software-based and radar-based procedure for tracking these sort of changes.
And still you got this sort of low-toss effect surface treatment now that can reduce that probably a little bit again.
Yeah. Before that, it was a surface, also there were this orange peel design of radars. And along the seams, the characteristics were very different, and people complained a lot about that. Now they make more of those random panels, try to compare the waxing with a special design of this the radome fibers, trying to reduce the effect, but only to a certain point anyway. Weak signals, low signals ratio, what to do, and. The bottom line is that ZDR and ROHV are biased by noise and signal noise ratio as large as 20 dB. And that definitely shows some artificial decrease or increase or whatever. Okay, ROHV, in other words, ZDR tends to be zero and ROHV decreases dramatically if you don't do any correction for noise. All right, there are different ways to address that, and have to measure noises in both orthogonal channels as accurately as possible. The noise can be different because we have two different receivers. Okay, then we can. What is being usually done in most of the system is simply subtract power noise from the power from the power. Of the sound signal, and use this subtraction for correcting differential between cross-correlation coefficient. Okay, and I will show you in the next slide that it may have sometimes only limited success. The most radical solution is used is our so-called one-lag estimates that are not biased by noise at all. For example, instead of dividing powers at horizontal vertical polarization U, you may divide this for covariances, auto-covariances at H and V that are not dependent on noise. And the same thing in ROHV. And that works very well, but that's only using this one-lag or multi-lag estimators we are capable to measure reliable differential effectivities, sometimes even signal ratio as low as minus 10, minus 15 dB. Okay, and this is... getting it started. All right, and this is examples from the next one. And you see that this operational view, okay, or operational product, this radial reflectivity, this differential reflectivity. This is, it's a differential phase, and this is. cross-correlation coefficient after correction. And at all next rad radars, we see some that the rim of the echo is overcorrecting, overcorrection of cross-correlation coefficient. It's more than one. You know, it's very annoying. It can be addressed, but again, the system is quite awkward, and it's very difficult to make some changes in software, especially if you're working in a government environment. It's very difficult. Whenever with the private companies, you can do it very, very easily, very quickly. But here you have to go through the chain of commands, and that actually that slows down this process tremendously. But anyway, this is an example. What happens when you are doing this signal-noise ratio correction inappropriately? Okay. So in fact, they are overestimating noise. And this overestimation projects into overestimation of the signals of cross-correlation coefficients of the echo. Attenuation correction. Yes, attenuation can be very, very big problem, especially at shorter wavelength. Here is it's a good example. Okay, you can dealing with these Oklahoma style beasts like mesoscale convective system. Approaching from here. All right, this is measurements. It's actually measured. It was a measurement made in 2005 or something like that. Then at around that time, we didn't have any X-band measurements at that time. We simply computed what would be the echo from X-band radar. Okay, you see that we have a very little thing, just at the, not even the false correlation. So the signal is totally attenuated, the matter of maybe 10 kilometers at X-band. Then more later, basically, we already acquired few X-band dot-pole radars over there, and had a luxury to compare the S-band and X-band measurements. And you see that again, very similar situation with squall line approaching, okay, S-band, X-band. In other words, X-band is all blind. You cannot do anything once you lost the signal entirely here. So, then, definitely, you know, in Germany, there will be not many situations like this. But there will be episode of almost total extinction of the signal within the, here you see this, only 5 kilometers. In 5 kilometers, X-band really doesn't see much. All right, that's one example. Let me show you probably different examples. Yes, this is, again, Oklahoma storm. Storm that produces tornado, maybe some tornado like hook here, something like that. And it was the subject of intense investigation. And it is S-band, where attenuation is relatively small. It's radar reflectivity, differential phase, and cross-correlation coefficient. All right, so, and then we have C-band radar standing nearby, and that's what it sees. So I toggle back and forth, S-band, C-band, S-band, C-band. Okay, so we are losing this radar reflectivity, which drops below with some sort of a level of 0 dBz, it's not shown here. Differential reflectivity here is it's minus 3, minus 4 dB. It should be positive. Okay, differential phase shows in what azimuth this attenuation actually takes place. That's the biggest benefit of differential phase. We know that along this direction there will be no much of attenuation. So indeed there is not much of attenuation or differential direction. Okay, it's only along these directions when we have differential phase exceeding 300 degrees, we have dramatic loss in radar reflectivity, attenuation of radar reflectivity, and differential reflectivity. Okay, and later on we show how we successfully actually retrieve those lost Zs and ZDRs, but not at the moment. Okay, there is another example. There is another example is RHIs. Again, This is C-band and this is S-band, the same storm looking from the perspective of two radars, C-band radar and S-band radar. Okay, for the S-band radar you have two distinctive cells with reflectivities exceeding 55 degrees Z, and in C-band we have, we see only one cell. Another cell is bigger on the top of another cell is good to see. So such a dramatic attenuation at C-band. Look at differential objectivity, total hole, so this differential objectivity is less than minus 5 dB, whatever, it's basically totally lost. Even in terms of cross-correlation coefficients, you get cross-correlation coefficients because of these effects of resonance scattering is lower at C-band compared to S-band. Alright, so differential objectivity here, look, it's positive, plus 2, plus 3 dB. That was expected for this sort of objectivity. And if it's negative, so from minus 5, it's totally off. Okay, that's a big challenge that this shorter wavelength crater actually face. Even S-band radars, it's one of the first storms during the official test of polarimetric instrument actually caused a lot of frustration in the public when we see along the squall line, ADAD, they see a pain manifestation of attenuation. Okay, we see some decrease in differential reflectivity, which makes little sense and goes to the negative values. But its biggest frustration was this sort of a drop in cross-correlation coefficient. That is not actually attributed to attenuation, but non-uniform beam feeding. That is sort of goes hand in hand with this attenuation. I will explain that in one of the slides later in the lecture. Okay. So these problems are, of course. It's a real occurrence when you have a squall line and the radar is looking just along the squall line. Okay, because five minutes before that, there will be no such a pronounced effect. But anyway, those takes place even in the So what to do and what are the techniques for attenuation correction? There were a few slides with formulas. Okay, not too many calls. So how to correct for attenuation? So in the presence of attenuation, radar reflectivity, attenuated radar reflectivity is a product of true intrinsic radar reflectivity multiplied by this attenuating factor, which is which can be expressed like this through specific attenuation. Okay, the integral exponent containing the integral along the radial. Okay. So if we assume that specific attenuation is a function of radar reflectivity itself, like that, which is not very good relation, but people still use that. So we can substitute A with this function of Z, and now it's sort of integral equation, because we have Z in this part of the equation and this part of the equation. Okay, and in 1954, this Hitchfield and Borden were the first to solve this equation. Solve the equation, okay, and find out the solution of that. Okay, it's called Hitchfield and Borden solution. So, but, or you can try to solve these equations iteratively, whatever. But the bottom line that in the absence of any sort of additional information, but only attenuated profile of radar reflectivity, you cannot do reliable attenuation correction for if path integrated attenuation exceeds 10 dB. And that's, we have often have much larger attenuation, especially at X-band or C-band. So they then actually satellite community came up with the so-called path integrated attenuation constraint solution. In other words, that relation that was shown in the previous slide, okay, and that solution can be improved if we have something that is, if we can measure independently path integrated attenuation. For example, there is a mountain somewhere, mountain with stable signal, and the rain between mountain and radar. Okay, so we can always, you know, that the in the absence of rain, the signal from mountain is very stable. Okay, then we see in the absence, in the presence of rain along the propagation path, how much the signal from the mountain actually decreases. And this decrease is basically path integrated attenuation, two-way path integrated attenuation. Or if they look from the, I mean, the satellite community, when it looks from the satellite, they look through the clouds, through the rain, but they see, say, sea surface or land surface. And sea surface, they believe that they have some sort of a relatively stable radar reflectivity. So they can compare this signal from the ocean in a situation with no rain and with the presence of rain. And they also saw all this path integrated attenuation. Okay. So in that situation, they can retrieve the radial profile specific attenuation. There are derivations that are rather tricky, but anyway, believe me, that's what the final result is. Okay. So it's possible to use this attenuated profile radar reflectivity, okay, which comes into this formula, okay, either like this or through the integrals that are in the denominator, okay. And this is some coefficient C, which is a function of path integrated attenuation. Okay. So knowing path integrated attenuation and all this attenuated profile ZA which are measured, so we can find relatively good estimate of specific attenuation. And after that, once you know specific attenuation, we can correct radar reflectivity for attenuation with decent accuracy. All right. So and this is approximate solution for that. Okay, which is another, it's a simplified solution. But look here, it's an interesting solution that we are trying to use a specific direction more for quantitative measurements of rain. And what it tells us that this estimate is immune to radar reflectivity biases caused by radar miscalibration, partial beam blockage. Because if you multiply ZA by a certain factor in the numerator and denominator in these integrals, so those factors are canceled out. That means that indeed this retrieved specific attenuation is immune to the biases caused by radar miscalibration, partial beam blockage. And we'll utilize that later on. One great advantage of dual pole is that the total differential phase is proportional to path integrated attenuation. That means that you don't need to have some sort of a standard reflector like a mountain or ocean or something like that that you can serve as a target, as a calibrating target. Okay, you may simply use the measurements of differential phase. Okay, this is because there is some sort of ratio between the good linear relation between specific attenuation and differential phase. Because look here, this is what bias of differential reflectivity look like. It's integral. Two integrals of specific attenuation integrate over the range. And differential phase is a similar integral but over KDP. So if this one and this one are linearly related in some sort of a factor, alpha. Okay. Very simply use this formula. So delta z is equal to alpha q dp, and similar thing for differential reflectivity. So in order to correct z and zdr for attenuation, you simply need to know q dp profiles and simply multiply it by certain factors. Another way is just to use this z phi method. Okay. Here we talk only total span of delta phi dp. PDP is utilized, and it has some advantages compared to this utilization. But anyway, this is the crux, this is the essence of the polarimetric correction of radar reflectivity in differential reflectivity at all radar wavelengths, especially beneficial for shorter wavelengths at C band and X band. So that's the essence of the matter. In other words, adding polarimetric capability to the radar makes radar measurements of rainfall really quantitative, okay, a shorter wavelength. Because now, because of these relations, we are capable to fix radar reflectivity and differential reflectivity as well. And from fixed radar reflectivity, we can measure rainway with less error from attenuated traffic. Unfortunately, those coefficients in that correction formulas are not constant. They're changing. They're changing the function of, for example, differential reflectivity, they're changing the function of the temperature. But again, we can use some sort of default values that may work well as a first approximation, first iteration of this attenuation correction process. Okay, those coefficients are different at S band, C band, and X band, so increasing with the decreasing wavelength. However, you know, if we use this simple, straightforward approach based on the use of differential phase, we are really made a lot of progress. Remember that one? Okay. The C-band image in the case of this tornadic storm in Oklahoma, when we lost a lot of radar reflectivity, differential reflectivity. And what we do when we do very simple correction, we simply multiply VDP by this factor and differential reflectivity by this factor and add to the measured radar reflectivity. And we see that we restore this miraculous. Very well. Then another example, it's a C-band
field compact. Okay. And how differential phases correct also?
Differential reflectivity is the same, but differential reflectivity, differential reflectivity here, it's a matter of plotting. Because I'm plotting that. You know, for I did plot differential phase for reflectivity is less than.
Okay.
So it exists there.
Okay.
If it doesn't exist, there was no angle. Yeah. We will not be able to do this correction. Okay. Because we need to do have something to multiply by the factor and add to radar reflectivity. So radar reflectivity is not noise. It's not lost there.
Okay.
However, it is totally lost. You cannot do anything. That's a distinction that you have to make. All right. That's another example, a C-band radar. It's all data from partners in Canada. So, what is this? Yeah, Z measured, and again, radar is somewhere here. And we along the squall line, we see some obvious degradation, and decrease in radar reflectivity. And differential reflectivity is dramatically dropped again. It's less severe case than Oklahoma, but it's Ontario, and I believe that those type of events can happen in Germany as well. So, and that, you know, we store other reflectivity and differential reflectivity, basically what we store, using that very simple algorithm. for attenuation correction. That's another case, and again, C-band radars in Valparaiso, Indiana, one of the first ABC beam radars. All right, if you look here, there was a very heavy thunderstorm in Chicago area, basically. All right, and this is what S-band radar shows, the huge score, a huge MCS again, score line with very high reflectivities along the, in the score line. Okay. And that was C-band radar shows. So radar, C-band radar located over here, 0, 0. Okay. And you see huge difference between this reflectivity along this line and this reflectivity that is measured by S-band radar. So S-band radar doesn't experience much of attenuation by definition. Also is located in such that, you know, there is not much of that. Propagation path through this heavily attenuating score line, whereas this looks just along the score line. So again, we have differential phase. We have differential phase, and we know where we have to expect the biggest attenuation-related bias in this direction, because VDP is highest in this direction. It's not not much of VDP over there. But overall, it's very, very strong. It's more than 500, I would say, degrees differential phase. Extremely strong differential phase. Okay, and once we apply this correction, attenuation correction technique, we are capable to restore the radar reflectivity just when the score line becomes very consistent with the one that is measured by the S-band radar. And if you look again into the attenuated profile of reflectivity and restored profile of reflectivity, it's amazing that you can restore radar reflectivity bias as large as 40 dBz almost. 40 dBz. And remember that the first non-polarimetric algorithm were capable to do somewhat, I would say, acceptable job, maybe for path integrated attenuation of only 5 or 10 dB. Be much better. What this means? This means that if 99.98% of signal is lost due to attenuation, you are still capable to do restore, to do restoration, and to do reasonably good rainfall measurements with this restored radar reflectivity. So that's so for C-band and X-band, there is no need to find any argument in favor of tremendous improvement in the quality of rainfall estimation and justify this polarimetric upgrade of C-band and X-band radars. For S-band, it's a little bit tricky because the improvement, there is no attenuation. There is a huge gain in attenuation correction. So I will talk about that in the last lecture. And this example for X-band. Example for X-band, the Japanese case. And here they have very juicy storms over there in the Tokyo area. It's a typhoon. All data. All right, this is Z uncorrected, Z corrected, ZDR uncorrected, ZDR corrected. Again, relatively simple algorithm based in differential phase is being utilized in this situation as well. Terrain-induced biases, partial beam blockage. Okay, there's an example of our old CINAR radar, which was barely seen in the grove here, in the woods, and that's why we have plenty of this as a function of azimuth, plenty of error, bias, here in differential reflectivity actually. So as a function of azimuth. So we look into stratiform rain, snow, many cases, and it shows the same pattern. Okay, same as the neutral pattern for rain, for stratiform rain and snow. So for partial beam blockage, radar reflectivity is negatively biased, always. Differential, okay, might be biased and might not be biased at all. For example, if you're looking on a bald mountain that doesn't have any vegetation like that, okay, mountain like this, and it has some sort of blockage of the beam, okay, this ZH and ZV are blocked proportionally, okay, and there is no change in, no bias in differential reactivity. However, you have the mountain with some trees, and that selectively pass H and V polarization, you may have ZDR bias, which is strong here. And again, if you look at this picture, all those trees, no, there's no bald mountains in Oklahoma. Okay, all these trees that make this very selective horizontal polarization. So, and what can be done? Generally, utilized technique is based on digital elevation map that's available now around the globe. So, pure geometrical consideration. So, you have to figure out at what level, at what angle the obstacle actually makes occultation of the beam, blocks the beam. And there are some relatively simple formula that can relate the degree of blockage and the factor F shield that has to be added to radar reflectivity in order to correct for this beam blockage. So if you have 50% of beam blockage, in other words, the top of the mountain or whatever hill is just in the middle of the beam, then half of the power is lost. So that means that radar reflectivity is about 3 dB less than it should be. Okay. However, we often deal with the situation of man-made obstacles like these buildings. And again, with all this Google Earth and everything else, we can do amazing things to figure out the actual occultation target for all radars everywhere in the world at different elevation, different hazards. Here's an example from Taiwan, heavily urbanized area. So there are some sort of mountains there that does partial beam blockage. But in addition to that, we have in a certain direction, we have also tall buildings that blocks the beam. So whenever we compare, whenever we take digital elevation map and compare the degree of blockage based on formulas from digital elevation map, which is shown here with the black dots, and compare with actual loss of power due to blockage, we figure out that whenever we have those artificial buildings or objects, so digital elevation map doesn't take it into account. So we have much more attenuation due to this sort of buildings. So we need to, that means that we need to think about the method that takes into account not only mostly natural targets that are being accounted for in digital elevation maps, but also the building like this, or nearby standing trees, which is also a big problem. All right. And you know what we did? We simply used the ZFE method from which we determined specific attenuation. Okay, and this attenuation is immune to partial beam blockage. So then we convert this A into rain rate, okay, and RI dependence is known for being very insensitive to size distributions, and I will talk about in the last lecture. Okay, and then we, since A is not affected by attenuation, and this is not affected by attenuation, but differential phase is not affected by attenuation because we are using differential phase to achieve its profile. Okay, so that means that rain rate is also immune to partial beam blockage. to partial converge. That's also immune to partial converge. And again, it's very simple algorithm. So R of Z shows this simply different scans. Okay, shows this very strong drop in radar field in rain rate from Z, because Z is negatively biased. And from A, this is absolutely no even sign of that. So it works very well and very efficient. And this is the results from Bonn. So radar reflectivity, and we know this blockage, well-known blockage, is 1.5 degree elevation. I'm not talking about half a degree elevation, okay, in this direction. That's quite a bit of power loss, maybe 20-25 dBz. All right, differential reflectivity, by the way, is not affected by that, which is interesting. Okay, then we have attenuated radar reflectivity combined with the total span of differential phase in the framework of the ZFE method, and figure out specific attenuation, and then use formula, although may not be very good, but anyway works in this case, that relates radar reflectivity to specific attenuation. Okay, we come up with, plus we do this attenuation correction of radar reflectivity using again the same thing. And you see that this first we are basically fixing the problem of attenuation and problem of partial blockage in one shot, which is very good. We are doing some studies just trying to figure out in what percent of cases we can, for example, in mountainous part of the western part of the United States, we can fix the problem of partial beam blockage. In other words, we find out the situation when this is basically in Oregon, in the near west coast, and here is a mountain, you have clear blockage of the radar beam. Okay, but differential phase, see, it's not affected. And if this happens, okay, of course, differential phase would be affected if the signal is totally lost. If we cannot measure differential phase at all. But if the signal is lost to the sense, to the degree that it's the differential phase is still measurable, like here, then we are fine. We can retrieve this precipitation using R of A method very, very comfortably. So here is a definite decrease, artificial decrease due to the blockage on Z before it was corrected. And this is when we use our way. And for this, we don't need even any digital duration map, which is another advantage of this map. A few slides, a few minutes. Groundwater contamination is very big and very quite complicated issues addressed for decades already. All right, and I just simply show a couple of slides. But basically, it's mostly addressed by different groundwater filtering, by signal processing, and the problem is that the user of the radar should determine, and very often it's very subjective decision, at what and where you have to apply this groundwater filter. So for this, the groundwater maps are being usually made based on statistics of large observations. You know where the targets that cause groundwater are. Okay, and apply only there. So polarimetry helps us just to classify those maps automatically, but classify the ground clutter and apply selectively ground clutter filtering where it has to be done. Because otherwise, when you do it indiscriminately, you've seen, I mean, in the case of this C-band DWD radar, it's a big areas of the near zero Doppler velocities, along zero Doppler velocity isotope, that the filter is indiscriminately takes out both ground cloud signal, which has intrinsic adopter velocity close to zero, and weather signal that appears to have zero adopter velocity in that particular theory. So all these adaptive filters, all these adaptive filters are that's the tendency using adaptive filters and plus classification. Okay, adaptive filters, Bayesian classification, polarimetric classification. Results, designations, that's the way to for ground cloud contamination mitigation. This is busy slide, so I don't want to just to read everything. So there's some plots showing how we are, how it can be bad and how it is being addressed if we are using, say, filtered fields of radar activity. Since cross correlation coefficients before filtering, after filtering, we still have some ground clutter. Okay, another example, quite impressive example, when we are in a rugged mountain area near Tucson in Arizona, a lot of signal from ground clutter, and it's basically gone after we use some so called cleaning method. To for ground cloud filtering, so we left only with radar echoes. Here we have some blockage, and we can use our wave method to fix that this problem as well. But just my comment on that. Another way is just simply do how to classify. We'll talk about this classification in the next lecture. Okay. But this is just to show you one of the very old slides when the polarimetric curve distinguished between anomalous propagation biological scatters and ground cloud anomalous propagation biological scatters and rain. If you look at radar reflectivity, it's very difficult to tell where everything is. Here, just maybe we suspect there is a ground cloud over there. What else? What is the origin of the rest of the echo? It's a question. The differential reflectivity tells us a lot. Okay, we know that for ground cloud, differential reflectivity close to zero or probably negative, so we need probably more ground cloud than meteorological scatters. And cross correlation coefficient, fantastic parameter. So if it's high, that means that if it's I'm sorry, for differential reflectivity. No, it's positive, but here very high. That means that here we're dealing with insects and birds or something like that. Okay, biota. Or a cross correlation coefficient tells us very clearly where we have pure meteorological echo, where cross correlation coefficient is high. Okay, and the rest is probably non meteorological echoes. So, in the classifications, when we just combine these three measurables in a very simple way, fuzzy logic, to figure out that, where rain is, and we have extended area of embedded anomalous propagation echoes. So we have super refraction, when the beam is just bent like that, and it actually reflects from the ground, from the meteorological scatters. So once we have that, once we have this map, we can selectively apply ground cloud filtering here, but not there. So that's the whole idea of improving quality data by addressing the ground cloud contamination issue. Okay. Another thing, just with a couple of more effects before the lecture ends. Negative effects that. adverse impact on the measurements. S band radar, ATED, one of the beginning of the official test of dual pole prototype next round in 2010. Again, we've seen that. I already showed this image, but don't show the classification. So if you look at this, you see some obvious attenuation manifestation and the drop in cross correlation coefficient. And again, when drop in cross correlation coefficient occurs, then all variables become very noisy, very unreliable. You can do very little actually in this area. But the question is why is this happening? Why cross correlation coefficient is affected? Because if you look at the expression of the cross correlation coefficient, you know, attenuation shouldn't affect that, the magnitude of cross correlation coefficient, because you have the, say, power of signal voltages in the numerator and denominator should be cancelled out. So there's something else happening here. And something else is non-uniform beam feeding. Okay, in other words, you know, if we have this sense of the cloud, okay, and the beam of the finite width, all right, so on the top of the beam, you do not penetrate too much of precipitation, so differential phase along that beam accumulation is not much, something like that. Whereas at the bottom of the beam, differential phase is much higher. So we have strong gradient of differential phase within the beam. Okay. And if we assume that there are probably somewhere here, there are a couple of scatterers, only a couple of scatterers, just two raindrops, in the top of the radar resolution volume near the top of the beam, and the bottom of the radar resolution volume in the bottom of the beam. And there are some mathematical expression for cross correlation coefficient, which is equivalent to the fact that ρHV is a sort of the vectorial sum of two vectors, okay? But if differential phase is for the bottom raindrop and top raindrops are very different, in other words, this angle and this angle is very different, then this the length of this vector becomes much, much less than one. So if they are the same, it makes two, and we have one. But because it's vectorial sum, it's much less than one. So that explains sort of in a very simplistic way this effect. So in other words, it is a gradient of differential phase, most often vertical gradient of differential phase that makes this effect happen. Okay, it is quite general effect, like here, it's another example. Very clear drop in the next rad case, very clear drop. And we have some formulas that quantifies this effect. In other words, if we have strong gradients along the azimuthal angle, along the elevation angle of the differential phase, we have this depression of cross correlation coefficient. Okay, the gradients of Z also affect the accuracy of differential reflectivity measurements and differential phase itself. So, and we call it NBF, non-uniform beam feeding effects, that often causes a very erratic looking data. Okay, and this is the examples of this thing here. This is as bad, the drop in cross correlation coefficient, because the gradient, vertical gradient differential phase is very strong in this area. The curse only this area, not over here. So another slide. At C band, again, you see this, whenever we have a transition from rain to snow above the freezing level, we see this drop in cross correlation coefficient a certain high. Not close to the ground, but maybe just where we have the highest gradient. Yeah, and that's very common effect, and you have to be used to that. And my final couple of slides just illustrate another strange effect, which is very visible. This is sort of a radial streak in differential between positive, negative, that often observed at a very high elevation in the crystal part of the cloud. Okay. And this is related to depolarization. That's another effect. And you see here, you see some sort of a radio, artificial radial streaks of negative, positive things. And at the moment, I simply don't have time just to dwell on that and explain why this happens. But these streaks also can be, these streaks are associated with the crystals that oriented neither horizontally nor vertically. And that's usually happened in electrically charged part of the clouds. Okay, they made this orientation, and as from the first lecture I made, I tried to convey the idea of depolarization because of that orientation. Okay, that what happens here. And from this I can show this is the negative zygia, that means that the crystal oriented like that is positive oriented like this. It's amazing. So that means that we can infer even the direction of the electrostatic field that produces separation of charges and orientation of these crystals. So we try to use this. Definitely a lot of people believe that it is some sort of an artifact. But there is recent idea that we can use it as a sort of glass half full idea. So because those streaks, manifestation of electric fields associated with driving in updrafts. So it can be utilized, especially in these winter storms, in very big reflectivities. Okay, you cannot see localization of updrafts here or convection, developing convection. But those things, very visible polarization streaks, tell us where the updrafts that create some sort of a relatively weak electric fields, but nevertheless strong enough to orient crystals. Okay. So, and the presence of these fields and the crystals that are being generated around that the top of Antarctica, it's one of the important keys to the understanding ice microphysics. So that's end of that lecture. Okay.